So we weren't in Luke last Sunday evening. We were recovering from a barbecue and other such things that happened last weekend. And so perhaps for my sake as much as yours, I've got an introduction to remind you where we are in this part of Luke. So it's now early on Friday morning, just a few short hours before Jesus will be crucified. The various religious and secular leaders have tried Jesus, though they had no power to alter his destiny. God has predetermined not just that Jesus should die, but the how and the where and the when of his death. As Phil has just mentioned, there's a total of 6 trials in all, of which this is the 5th. And if you're beginning to lose track of where we are, if you're not quite sure, I really recommend that you either go on the internet or you ask the nice gentleman at the back to give you a disc version of some of those preachers that you might have missed or some of the ones that you haven't quite got in your head. They are exceptionally good. The quality is somewhat different and some of the faces on there. But the content is good and worth looking at. You see, the Sanhedrin have ratified the sentence of Jesus as a blasphemer. That's the charge that came before them, and that's what they agreed he was. He's a blasphemer. He claims to be God. But they don't have the power to carry out the sentence of death on him, and so they've passed him on. They've brought him to the authorities, the Roman authorities. So Jesus has been tried by the Roman Senate's representative in the area, that's Pilate. We must remember that as Jesus' ministry started, we read the list of relevant politicians in the area. And it seems like a long time ago because it was. When we read in Luke 1 and the first part of verse 1, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judah, Herod the Tetrarch of Galilee. And then it goes on. But those are the characters we're looking at, set out for us clearly at the beginning of Scripture. The historical facts are there, and we're revisiting those people now. You see, Pilate, this Roman representative, was afraid of both the Jewish leaders and of Jesus himself. Pilate could not condemn Jesus to death based on the charge of blasphemy, as he did not believe in God or the faith that Jesus was accused of blaspheming. He didn't believe what these people were coming to tell him about in the first place, so Jesus couldn't possibly be a blasphemer, speaking against that faith. Therefore, the Jews have brought the charge that he was an insurrectionist and a threat to Rome. That's why they've now brought him to Pilate. They couldn't try him under their own court, but they brought him to Pilate. And they had to make up a different charge, because blasphemer wouldn't do. They said he's a threat to Rome. Matthew 27 and verse 22a, it says, "What shall I do then with this Jesus who's called Christ?" That's what Pilate says. That's his dilemma. They've brought him with a charge, now they're changing their minds and changing what that charge might be. What shall I do then with Jesus who's called the Christ? And that's a question, as individuals, every person who's lived before and since on this earth has to answer that question for themselves. What shall I do with this Jesus who's called Christ? And many of us have made that decision. But we know many, many, many people in our workplaces, among our family, among our friendship group, who've either fudged that question or not faced up to that question, or hope because they live in Britain that that question has been answered on their behalf in the right way. They don't understand that they too have personally got to answer that question. Pilate was unhappy about the request to execute Jesus because he recognized the Jews' motives and found nothing criminal about Jesus' behavior. People spoke well of him. Nobody else came with accusations against him. So he sent Jesus to Herod, who then ruled the area which included Galilee. How weak Pilate, this man with power of life and death, actually was. He lacked the courage to act on his own convictions. He was a prisoner of circumstance, the ruler who was ruled by the fear of getting it wrong. In these circumstances, only Jesus that has the integrity. And I wonder what Pilate expected of Herod as he sent him off, packaged him up and sent him. Jesus has been passed from the Sanhedrin to Pilate, and now from Pilate to Herod. So tonight's reading highlights the interaction between Jesus and Herod, whom Phil described this morning as interesting, whatever that's supposed to mean. The passage here is unparalleled in the other Gospels. It doesn't appear in the other Gospels, this reference. So let's find out what there is here in this passage for us. And as we think about Herod, and as we think about the interaction between the two, I'm going to be quite personal and ask you about some of the issues that Herod faced, some of the things that are highlighted by Herod's behavior. And you're either going to like that and think, well, that's good application, or you're going to hate it because you don't like being asked questions that put you on the spot. Let's give it a go. When he, that's Pilate, learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. Herod would have been in Jerusalem for the Passover feast. He'd come to be at the temple, to be seen in the temple. Pilate had the authority to try Jesus. He'd committed a crime in Pilate's area of jurisdictions, but sometimes the right of extradition was allowed. And Herod might thus be free to try Jesus for a crime committed in Galilee. Pilate's got sloping shoulders. He can't sort it out. So he's thinking, oh, how am I going to get out of this situation? What am I going to do? I can't make up my mind. It's all too difficult for me. I can't be bothered. Ah, he came from Galilee. Good-o. Herod's the man. By refusing or talking about the jurisdiction, Pilate could take the matter out of his own hands. He could legally pass him on. He was hoping thus to escape the dilemma of an unjust condemnation of Jesus or becoming unpopular with the religious Jewish leaders by releasing him. He was frightened of both. He wanted to be popular. This was a difficult place to govern. It was one of the places on the outer reaches of the Roman Empire, and it was hard there. The people weren't nice to them. They hadn't welcomed them with open arms. They kept rioting. There were often insurrections. It was a difficult place. And Pilate was serving out time there before perhaps he'd get a better job, somewhere closer to home, something more exciting perhaps. So he was looking for a way out. He was looking for something else that he could just turn his mind to, get this off his plate, move it on, keep it going. So when we start our reading, we read that Jesus was with Herod. He'd been sent to Herod. He'd been sent there. And it reminds me of something I teach under fives at Spring Harvest on a regular basis. Something that's important to me and should be important to you. about the presence of Jesus. He's now in Herod's presence. He's now with Herod to look after. And so when we have under fives and we want to talk to them about the Lord Jesus, we ask them to put up their hands. And we say, Jesus is always with me. As a reminder to them as they go away, something that they have with them and can take with them. And like those children, I'd like you to remind you of some things about that. Jesus, strong thumb, strongest limb, strongest digit. Jesus is always, always is on that longest finger to remind us how long always is. Jesus is always with me, to remind us of our position. The weakest, littlest finger that we have. It's sort of on the end there. It gets wrapped around things when everything else is wrapped around things. It doesn't have a use on its own. You don't stick stamps on it like you do your thumb or point with it. It's just a little digit on the end. Jesus is always with me. Matthew says this, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. It didn't matter where Jesus physically was at this particular time. It didn't matter that he's in Herod's presence and he's moved away from being with Pilate. The truth is that he was always going to be with them both, as well as always with you and I. And unlike Herod, we can't just, unlike Pilate and Herod, as we're going to see later, we just can't fudge the issue. We have decisions to make. We have to decide. So he's off to see Herod. But Herod wanted something from Jesus. What did Herod want from Jesus? Verse 8 says, when Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he'd been wanting to see him. For he'd heard about him, and he hoped to see him perform some miracles. This is the Herod, the one that had murdered John, as recorded in Mark's Gospel. Mark chapter 6, starting at verse 14. King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had become well known. Some were saying John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why miraculous powers are at work in him. Others said he's Elijah, and still others claimed he's a prophet, like one of the prophets from long ago. But when Herod heard this, he said, John, the man I beheaded, has been raised from the dead. Well, Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had bound him and put him in prison. And he did this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. You see, there's a background going on here. This is a man that he's known about. Herod has heard about and longed to see. Herod's top of the tree. He would have seen all the important people, and there's this one. He's been involved in our story already. We've already heard how he was an important leader at the time Jesus came to his ministry. And now we're reminded again how he had John put to death, because John spoke out against him. He clearly wants to find out much more about Jesus, and this was the opportunity to see him in the flesh and perhaps even see him perform, as though he was some sideshow act, as though he was some thing to toy with, a rich man with one of his many toys, one of his many possessions, one of any crowd around him to bring him pleasure. He had no understanding of who this Jesus was. He had no understanding beyond his own selfish needs. We we live in a world of selfish people. And if we're not careful, we find ourselves being selfish people as well, thinking that the world revolves around us. Children often believe that the world revolves around them, and as soon as they leave somewhere, then it all goes dark and waits for them to come back again. But they're the only true and real thing in the universe. But Herod's a grown man, and he still has that belief, and he still has the opinion that Jesus is just there to meet his needs. That's what he wanted from Jesus, somebody to perform, somebody to interest him, not to challenge him. I wonder what we want from Jesus. Here's four things that I thought of. Perhaps we want a friend. John 15, 15b says, "Instead, I've called you friends, for everything I've learned from my Father, I've made known from you." That's mind-blowing. That's just amazing. That Jesus wants us to be his friend. He doesn't need us. There's nothing we can bring. It's not like we're playing a game of football in the playground and we want the best footballer to be our friend just as our team works well. I guess the same works in netball, but I don't really know. But Jesus wants us to be his friends. So little we can give, so much we get. We want a counselor. Isaiah 9:6 is a well-known verse, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor. Wonderful Counselor. We might have counselors who sort out our finances, or counselors who sort out legal issues for us, or counselors that sort out our bag backs, or counselors, and we pay lots of money for good ones. But in front of Herod, where he could have been a counselor to him, that's not what Herod wanted. But it's what you and I need. Something we don't deserve, something we can't pay for, but a wonderful counselor. He came to be our guide. Isaiah 58 verse 11 says, "The Lord will guide you always." If we know him and love him as our Lord and Saviour, he promises to be our guide. Foolishly, we sometimes ignore him and get lost. You probably have a sat-nav in your car. Do you ever get to the point where you think, "Oh, this sat-nav doesn't know where it's going. I'm going to do my own thing. I can clearly see where I want to go. Is it to the right and it's telling me to go to the left?" And you end up going the wrong way down a one-way street. Or getting very lost if you're a man because you can't turn back and go the way you've already come. No. So you have to keep going. If I turn right and right and right again, I'll get back to where I've been before. It doesn't seem to work like that sometimes. He says he will guide us always. Herod didn't want a guide. Herod didn't need a guide. Why did he need a guide? In his own eyes, he was top of the tree. He was everything. We need a king. Herod didn't need a king. So Pilate asked Jesus, in the passage that we read earlier in verse 3, so Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Yes, it is as he said," Jesus replied. If you and I were in that position, we might have said a whole lot more. We might have said, "Yeah, and I'm king of you too, and him. And that lot over there. In fact, I'm king of the universe." But he didn't. because he is king in all those aspects. But he wants to be our king because we ask him, invite him. See, Jesus didn't answer Herod. Not a word passed from Jesus' lips that's recorded for us during his time before Herod. Clearly, time was of the essence now, because the Roman authorities, whatever was going to happen, they just wanted it to happen soon. Time was pressing. The Jews wanted it to happen soon, because it was Passover and time was pressing. But in all this chaos and mayhem, in all this push to get things done urgently, all this need to sort things out, Jesus stands there meek and mild before Herod, who apparently had control over his destiny. Verse 9 says, he plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. Jesus gave him no answer. As we've already read, Luke 3 says, so Pilate asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Yes, it is as you say, Jesus replied. But Jesus saw no value in talking to Herod. Jesus saw no value in talking to Herod. There's this quote from Matthew chapter 7, verse 6. Do not give dogs what's sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and then turn and tear you to pieces. Jesus saw no value in talking to Herod. I'm so pleased he saw value in talking to me. I'm so glad that he talks to each one of us and gives us opportunity to respond. Herod had heard many things about this Jesus in Galilee, and out of curiosity, he'd longed to see him. You see, the poorest beggar, it appeared, had asked for a miracle and were never denied. But this proud prince, who asked for a miracle only to gratify his curiosity, has refused. Show me something, Jesus. Show me something. Answer my questions. Come on, you're here to perform for me. Don't you understand? I have power over your destiny. No, you don't. Jesus repeatedly refused to answer Herod, who merely wanted to see him perform some miracle. No one can manipulate Jesus. I don't know what your prayer life's like, but I'm happy to confess that mine's not very good at times. And I remember times as a younger Christian, and I'm sure I'm more subtle about it now, but you'd say things like, oh, Jesus, if you just gave me that nice car, I'd be able to fill it with people and take them all to church with me. Jesus, if you just gave me a bit more money, I promise I'll put most of it in the collection. That's immature, isn't it? That's trying to manipulate Jesus for our own purposes. Not saying, here I am, Lord, use me. All that I have is yours already. Use it all. No one can manipulate Jesus, but Herod tried. Herod and his court wanted some sport from this upstart, just as the Philistines had with Samson. It's a lovely story, the story of Samson, how he was given such great gifts by God and given a purpose in life by God, and then he fell in with a woman. end of all things, falling in with women. He fell in with a woman who wanted to use and abuse him. Nagged him continually. Don't know anybody like that. Nagged him continually until he told her what his the secret of his strength was. And the Philistines captured him because he said too much. But Samson got his own back. Right at the end of his life, we read. While they were in high spirits, they shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." Sounds a bit like Herod, doesn't it? Bring out Jesus to entertain me. I deserve entertaining. Bring out Samson to entertain us. So they called Samson out of prison and he performed for them when they stood him among the pillars. And we know how badly that ended for them. But Jesus had been warned of the nature ambitiousness of Herod before. But his response had been this. In Luke 13, we come across warnings about Herod. Luke 13:31. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else." It's very interesting. The Pharisees were concerned about Jesus. "Leave this place," the Pharisee says, "and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox, I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow, and on the third day, I'll reach my goal. In any case, I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside of Jerusalem." Oh, something about 3 days going on there. And Jerusalem. Nobody understood. Jesus said nothing to Herod. That really wound him up. How do we find, when we don't hear anything from Jesus, how do we find it when sometimes people describe the heavens as being brass? We pray about something and we don't seem to get an answer. We're urgently needing to know what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to do it. Nothing appears to happen. Does it make us feel nervous? Does it make us feel as if he's left us? Does it make us feel that he no longer loves us anymore? Is that how it makes us feel? You don't have to tell me, just think about it. I'm sure as mature Christians we understand that that's not the case. But in those lonely, dark places, when we have a need that's on our hearts, either for ourselves or somebody else, and we keep praying and nothing appears to happen. I wonder about Job. I often wonder about Job. You see, Job was tested and he felt far from God. And because of his circumstances and his associates' view, he believed that God had abandoned him. That's what the people came to comfort him with. Give up on God. He's given up on you. You give up on him. But with the help of a fellow believer, he realized that God was always with him. Job 42. Then Job replied to the Lord, "I know that you can do all things." Having been almost reintroduced back to God, having the world telling him that his God didn't exist and wasn't there and didn't love him anyway, even if he was there, this fellow believer has come and reminded him about how much God loved him. "I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. You asked, 'Who is this that obscures my counsel without knowledge?' Surely I spoke of the things that I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, 'Listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me. My ears had heard you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." As Jesus stood before Herod and said nothing, it wound him up. It upset him. Sometimes we feel that God has abandoned us. Sometimes we feel that God isn't speaking to us. Jesus has stopped communicating with us, and it winds us up. But like Job, we need to be reintroduced to a God who does care. Jesus wasn't speaking because there wasn't anything to say. Jesus wasn't speaking because he knew that what he was going to say wasn't going to be listened to and acted upon. There was no point in speaking to Herod, because Herod only wanted entertainment. And perhaps if God isn't speaking to us at times, it's because we're not listening, or we don't want to know, or we just want the entertainment. Not because he doesn't love us and doesn't care for us, but because he wants us to be humble before him. Herod toys with his prey. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and the soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. Now, the first few times I read this, I had a picture in my mind of poor Jesus being all alone, and Herod and a few of his close people there as well, asking him questions, and Jesus stood there quite passive and not making a response. But actually, that's not the case at all. Because the chief priests and teachers of the law were standing there. They'd come with him. These were the men that had decided that this man had got to die, and were so driven by that that they'd taken him to Pilate. They were standing there as well as Jesus stood before Pilate. And when Pilate moved him on to Herod, they were still so driven with wanting to get rid of this man, to just wipe him off the face of the earth, to get him out of the way. I nearly said out of their hair, but I realised that wasn't appropriate. They're here still. Pursuing him. Wanting their way with him. Wanting to just rid the earth of him. You have to admire their zeal, if nothing else. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. This Herod was in Jerusalem for the greatest of Jewish festivals. That's why he's here. But his lifestyle shows no sign of a relationship with the living God. He's come to the biggest God-worshipping festival there was at the time. He wants to be there. But it's not because he's come to worship God. It's to be worshipped by those around him. This Herod, whose ego inflated by his inclusion in these events by the Roman governor, as an indication of his own social status, rather than a sign of the moral ineptitude of that same Roman governor. He must have been really pleased when Pilate sent him, Jesus. Oh, look, I'm being included in the things the Romans are going to do. Oh, I can really increase my position with those nice Romans down the road. Herod, whose inability to gain any response from Jesus would mean that he would be shown to be spiritually and morally bankrupt, that many believed him to be. He couldn't even get Jesus to talk to him, let alone do a miracle for him. He couldn't even get Jesus to speak, let alone judge him. He couldn't even get Jesus to speak, let alone acknowledge him as being his superior in any way at all. Jesus made him look a fool in front of his men. Jesus made him look a fool in front of the chief priests and the teachers of the law that accompanied Jesus to him, with him, accompanied Jesus to him. This band of vile people that want to see done away with him, who've travelled now, who've judged him and travelled again, are just despairing of the weakness of these supposed leaders. One man, all these different court procedures, and he's making a fool of all of them by not even saying anything in this case. He gets Jesus dressed. Seems to be a bit of a theme, dressing and undressing Jesus. Undressing him to make him look inadequate, naked, weak, poor. Dressing him up in clothes that are supposed to be regal looking to poke fun at him. Dresses Jesus in an elegant or white robe, as some of the translations say, which was a characteristic of Jewish kings. The apparel, this would have been appropriate mockery from Herod's bodyguard. Look at him, King of the Jews. Herod then sent Jesus back to Pilate without passing any judgment in the case, because he hasn't heard a case. Jesus hasn't given him anything at all. What gives him the right to judge Jesus anyway? You see, the friendship of these wicked men, they agree little except in the enmity to God and contempt of Christ. Herod toys with his prey and gets nothing from it. Question to my heart and your heart, principally my heart, is, do I toy with Jesus? Do I promise something to him but never deliver? Do I pay lip service to him? Do I talk much but do little? Do I say more than if through my mouth and actually goes on in my heart? Do I please myself about my relationship with him? About prayer and Bible study? Do I live a life in which I live as if I've been adopted into the family of the living God through the ultimate sacrifice? Luke 17:5-6 says, the apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. He replied, if you have a faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. That's strange sort of faith. But you understand what it means. Is that the sort of faith I have? In Luke 8, verse 21, it says, he replied, my mother and my brothers are those who hear God's word and just learn a bit more tomorrow. Oh, no, I didn't say that. He replied, my mother and my brothers are those who hear God's word and to put it into practice. Herod and Pilate became allies in the pursuit of his eradication. Not doing too well. They're both failed. But in their failure, they can console each other and come to terms with it as brothers in failure, it would seem. Verse 12 says, that day Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they'd been enemies. That's a strange friendship. It's a friendship built on inactivity. It's a friendship built upon inability to get a job done. It's friendship based on, I don't know, humiliation. You see, Herod and Pilate had plenty of opportunities to become rivals for power and wealth and influence. Their sphere of influence overlapped. It was convenient for Pilate to send him to Herod just to get him out of the way. Not because Pilate believed it was Herod's job, because Herod had a higher position than him. You see, there have been rumours about the actions of these leaders. Again, earlier in Luke 13:1, it says, Now there were some present at the time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. He wasn't a well-liked man. Herod wasn't a well-liked man. They weren't good leaders. They weren't honest leaders. They were corrupt people. And in their corruption, they've joined together and become friends. So Pilate honours Herod with a sign of friendship based on mutual failure. A sign of friendship which would lead to the influence in Jerusalem, which in the ruling classes often meant a political alliance. They'd failed. So they sort of became buddies to help each other out. They become allies as they try to suppress things that they didn't like. There's a sort of agreement in failure to watch each other's backs. These men of different religions, a different social class, of different background, different nationality, have become allies together, working together in failure. And I have just one more question for us tonight. Who are our allies? Who are we closest to? Whose opinions do we value? Who do we choose to spend time with? This is an alliance of failure. This is an alliance of despair, that they're unable to do something more positive, more definite, more showy with this man they believe was just an upstart. Just a man who had a few words that the crowds followed. Who are we closest to? Who are our allies? Whose opinions do we value? Who do we choose to spend time with? Proverbs perhaps can help us. Proverbs 18:24 says, a man of many companions may come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. The proverb, of course, speaks about a personal relationship with Jesus. Are we men and women of many companions? A wide circle of friends. Nothing wrong with that. we have a friend who sticks closer than a brother. If we know the Lord Jesus Christ, our personal Lord and Saviour, he will stick closer than a brother. Are we determined to do the same to him? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we've looked at this passage tonight, as we've thought about this time that Jesus spent before Herod and didn't say anything, we wonder about Herod. And perhaps the elements of Herod's humanity in ourselves still. We pray that we'd know you as our personal Lord and Saviour, a friend that sticks closer than a brother. That we'd evaluate those around us. We'd evaluate our opinions, our attitudes, what we say, what we do, in the light of your love for us. Father, we pray that we'd be those who are diligent in not only maintaining a relationship with the Lord and Saviour that we know, if we already have that relationship, but seeing it grow deeper day by day. That we'd know the Lord Jesus as a friend who's closer than a brother to us, whose presence we long to be in, whose company we long to keep, whose advice and help we long to seek, who guides and directs us each and every day. Help us, we pray, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.